Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 11th meeting in 2022 of the Public Audit Committee. Before we begin, can I remind members, witnesses and staff present that social distancing arrangements need to be respected, and that if you are moving around the room or entering or leaving the room, if you could wear a face covering whilst you're with us at the table, you do not have to wear a face covering. The first item for the committee is to consider taking agenda items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed? Yep, I have assent for that. Next item on our agenda is to look at something which the committee has taken an interest in over a number of years, which is the oversight and governance arrangements for major ICT projects in Scotland. And so we have with us this morning, to give evidence on that, a number of representatives from the Scottish Government. Sharon Fairweather, who's the Director of Internal Audit and Assurance. Jeff Huggins, who's the Director Digital. Jonathan Ruff, who's the Head of Digital Strategy and Policy. And Donald McGilvery, who's the Director of Safer Communities. We're going to go straight into questions, and I want to begin by asking something which is, a matter which is preying on many of our minds. The National Cyber Security Centre has issued organisations with guidance about what to do given the heightened state of alert around cyber attacks. I wonder whether one of you could tell us whether the Scottish Government has been having discussions with public sector bodies about that heightened risk of cyber attack in light of the Russian invasion of Ukraine.
Yeah, I think that one's from you, Convener. So the short answer is yes. We are aware of a heightened risk on the back of the Ukraine invasion. Russia as a state actor and also some non-state actors are a particular threat in the cyber world. So as you say, the National Cyber Security Centre has set out a heightened state of awareness. We've been very active in pushing that out and amplifying that to our public bodies in Scotland. We have regular meetings of our National Cybersecurity Partnership. We have a monthly bulletin, but we've gone out with specific communications to all public bodies to make them aware of the heightened threat at present. What I would say is that there's no specific threat to Scotland or the Scottish public sector at the moment. It's very much a case of heightened awareness, making people aware and being extra vigilant, but I would want to stress that there's no specific threat to Scotland at the moment, Convener.
Okay, thank you. But has the state of alert been increased in light of events that have unfolded over the last few weeks?
Very much so. It's, you know, as I say, we've been very, very active through, you know, we have a very much an established network of cybersecurity professionals across the public sector in Scotland, and we've been very active through that network, drawing their attention to the NCSC alert and the NCSC guidance, reinforcing some of our kind of core messaging around cyber resilience, standards, tools, those kind of things. So that's absolutely the space we've been in over the last few weeks, Convener.
Thank you. And just for the sake of completeness, so there haven't been any cyber attacks by Russian sources over the last 6 weeks?
So there have been a couple of incidents, cyber incidents, that have been reported to us over the last 6 weeks. There's one that's in the public domain, that's the Scottish Association of Mental Health, that suffered a very serious cyber attack a couple of weeks ago. There's none that I'm aware that we have traced, you know, that we have linked in any way to the Ukraine conflict or specifically to a Russian threat linked to Ukraine. So incidents happen from time to time. I'm not aware that the recent incidents over the last few weeks have any specific link to the Ukraine situation, Convener.
Thank you, but you clearly remain vigilant.
Yes.
Right, thank you.
Can I maybe...
Yes, Mr Huggins, yes, please come in.
Just in terms of what we're doing within the Scottish Government ourselves for the technology that we're responsible for. So we've been working with NCSC through the checklist of additional measures that they're recommending, and that's an evolving checklist. My team are meeting weekly with other public bodies as well in terms of information sharing. During the last 4 or 5 weeks, we have run also a cyber tabletop exercise to get a better understanding of how we would respond in that context. We have seen some additional activity. I guess one of the reflections on that is it may not be directly linked to Ukraine or Russia, but it may be within the context of that. And, you know, malicious organisations able to operate, you know, under the cover of that and in the shadow of that, in a way in which they might otherwise not have done. So we're continuing to be vigilant. We also have raised increased the risk in respect of the likelihood on our risk register, and, you know, we've had conversations with our executive team and also briefed ministers and kept them involved in what's going on as well. So it's and what we're doing is what each public body will be doing across Scotland.
Right, thank you. And I think we may return to these themes later on in the session. But I'm going to now turn to Sharon Dowie, who is joining us through a video link this morning. Sharon, over to you.
Good morning. Audit Scotland's 2019 Enabling Digital Government report noted that governance and management structures for overseeing the 2017 digital strategy was confusing, and that the roles and remits should be kept under review and clearly articulated. So could you tell us about the governance and management structures for overseeing the delivery of the Scottish Government and COSLA digital strategy that was published in March 2021?
I'll be happy to pick that up. So following publication of the strategy last year, across the summer and into the autumn of last year, we worked with COSLA to put in place appropriate overarching governance arrangements for the strategy. So there is now a joint ministerial oversight group which will meet 4 times a year, focused on the delivery of the commitments within the strategy and the benefits realisation. It met for the first time at the beginning of March, with an agenda focused on the, you know, reporting arrangements, you know, in respect of the different commitments. And the intention is it'll meet again in the summer and then in the autumn, and we'll refine that approach as we work through it, identifying those people accountable for particular commitments, looking to the wider benefits that we're seeking to deliver. In that, quite often you can do all the things that you said you were going to do but not get the benefit you said you were going to achieve. So thinking beyond simply the particular deliverables, and using that both for internal management of the strategy, but also external public reporting in terms of what's actually being achieved under the strategy. In addition to that, within the Scottish Government, we did a piece of work across the autumn looking at the, I guess, what we might describe as the connective tissue in terms of how we deliver digital functions across a complex organisation in a way that can give us assurance and confidence about what we're doing. And as part of that, we'll be reforming the and changing what was previously the Central Government Digital Transformation Board, to create a digital board which brings together senior directors within the Scottish Government, along with representatives of the NDPBs and the delivery agencies. And the intention is that then will also, it will be, I guess, the staging post for the material that goes to the ministerial COSLA group in terms of confidence about delivery. But it'll also look at the horizontal issues, you know, the things which we need to do across government in respect of many commitments and many projects. So GDPR, assurance, capability, you know, those areas which are key ingredients to a successful delivery of a programme of work. And, you know, we anticipate it'll meet in its new format, I think in May, in June, for the on the first So that'll be the first meeting in that format. So we've taken quite seriously the 2019 report, and very much it was a key document that we were looking at as part of that review that we did internally in terms of how we operated. On the other side, and it's helpful that you mentioned this was a joint strategy. It's the first joint digital strategy. We're aware that the Local Government Digital Office, COSLA, and Solus have also been working in respect of their commitments under the strategy to identify appropriate governance and coordination work to work across the 32 councils. But it's probably not really for me to comment on that.
Sorry, did you say there's two groups that's meeting there? You said that there was one group that had met for the first time in March, which I take it is March 2022, and there's another meeting that's due to take place for the first meeting in June 2022. So is that two different groups looking at it?
So there's the ministerial and COSLA groups, so Councillor McGregor and Kate Forbes, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy, chair that. Then there's an official level group, which is producing the material that would flow into that ministerial group. And that official level group replaces a previous group, which is probably maybe a bit more amorphous in terms of its functions and responsibilities. And you know, I think perhaps led to the comments in the 2019 Audit Scotland report. So it's got a clearer and more direct remit with responsibility for coordination and securing delivery of the strategy.
That's fine. So you're quite happy that you've taken on board all the comments from the 2019 report?
I thought they were on point and they were helpful. And you know, our objective is to deliver good quality public services and value for money. And things which enable us to do that are good news.
Thank you. Back to you, convener.
Thanks, Sharon. We've now got some questions on governance, assurance and oversight of major ICT projects. And I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey, who is also joining us this morning through video link. So, Willie, over to you.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to everybody on the panel. I'm hoping to ask a couple of questions relating to the technical assurance framework and progress with that, but colleagues, you're bound to recall that some of the key reasons that ICT projects failed in the past was a number of factors. Project planning, probably the application or the lack of application of quality management processes, skills identification, skills problems in the mix were always a problem too. So there's a number of issues the committee felt over the years that gave rise to projects running over time and over budget, and perhaps the I6 project was a particularly bad example of all of that. We could see from our perspective that things tended to be rushed from the start, poorly defined, too many changes along the way, all of which led to these overruns, and in fact the I6, as I recall, was abandoned altogether. So I wonder, Jeff, and maybe Johnny as well, could you give us a bit of an overview of where you think we are now with all of those types of issues, and whether you think we've captured those particular problems and the processes that we embrace and the various frameworks that we have are working and in place for successful delivery?
So there's quite a few. That's quite a big question. I'll pick off some elements of it, and I'll maybe invite Sharon to come in and talk about the assurance process as well. That's been put in place and how that's changed. I think if we go over the, you know, the reports from this committee and from Audit Scotland, we can identify over the years that a number of things haven't gone the way in which we might have expected, and the items that you identify, poor planning, unrealistic expectations around time, absence of capability, those are all elements which we're now familiar with. In terms of the work that we're doing across SGA and the wider public bodies, we're focused on addressing a number of those areas. So if you take the area of capability and the availability of digital skills, digital professionals within the delivery pipeline, there's a number of things that we're doing there to increase the to increase that resource and that strength, but also to, you know, I guess help colleagues who maybe aren't digital colleagues actually understand where these professional skills fit in the same way that we use, you know, accountants and lawyers and economists and statisticians. These are particular skills. So growing that capability across government and then using it wisely is a key component of the work. In terms of the forecasting and finance, again, it's generally a lot easier to look back at the end of a programme and understand how it ran rather than to know how it's going to run. And one of the challenges I think that we face is that we could invest a lot and more time and money up front trying to work through every scenario and plan for every eventuality. But there's a question as to when where the proportionality is, to whether we actually might end up spending more money and taking longer to do something by trying to close off all risks. So I think the model whereby we apply good planning through the, you know, the business case model with the using the finance manual, using the learning that we have from previous programmes, but also then building in contingency, you know, expecting things won't run exactly as we predict. Understanding that there may be challenges with partner bodies, that there may be, you know, what we might describe as, you know, gotchas along the way, where something appears and surprises us in terms of the delivery of a programme. So within that, for those areas where there's maybe less uncertainty, building in the expectation that time may move and budgets may move. So applying, you know, the idea of contingency, you know, addressing overconfidence, you know, in a careful and sensible way. So there'll be some things that we know how much they cost and how long they take for any project, but there'll be other elements of it which we'll only really know once we get into the process. And part of that's also the, you know, the strong emphasis on design and working with end users of products, in that you can only really do that during the process of delivery. You can't do that ahead of the delivery process. So each of these areas, you know, we're building on the learning. I think you can be assured that we pay a lot of attention to both this committee's reports and Audit Scotland's reports, and they are the things that keep, you know, people like myself awake at night in respect of individual programmes and projects that we're responsible for. You know, the concern that we might not know all that we need to know. And you know, that iterative process of learning from previous successes and failures is important. There's another element maybe just to touch on as well. We do relatively few different things through technology. We pay people, you know, we record information, you know, we make assessments, we share, we notify people, we inform people. Yeah, but we then tailor those to very particular services. So whether that's in social security, in education, or in justice, the key element of that is, we need to increasingly standardise the processes and technologies that we're using to do those different things. So COVID showed us that with things like the COVID Status app, we could move very quickly where we used a series of off-the-shelf components which we already had. And the challenge became assembly of those components, and testing and user testing to actually deliver them in practice. And with that, that meant we could have both confidence that of the robustness of the technology quickly, but we could also take it from a request to delivery in 3 to 4 months, you know, without an extensive business planning process, without, you know, 16 gateway reviews. But that approach of thinking, being smarter about how we use existing technology and infrastructure, I think is key to the next 5 years of public sector technology. Sharon, do you want to say a bit about the assurance process?
Yes, certainly. So I think now that the technology assurance framework has become well established, we have over 500 projects now on our register. So the process that we do of going out to the public bodies every 6 months to get information is now a well-practiced process, and the bodies are now becoming much more forthcoming with information at an earlier stage around projects that they are considering, which is giving us the opportunity to get in there much earlier to help support them as they develop their plans around projects, and that's a good thing. And when we look at the statistics for the reviews that we undertake, both for major projects and around digital Scotland standards, we find that of the reviews, if I look at the statistics for the last 5 years, maybe only about 30% of reviews give a clear Bill of Health and allow the project to proceed to the next stage without requiring any remedial action. But that demonstrates that we are now getting at a much earlier stages of these projects and programmes to help keep these projects and programmes on track to be doing what they need to be doing at an earlier stage of the programme before they proceed to the next stage. And I think that that's a very good sign that that's now happening and that the assurance framework is now well embedded. We have to take a risk-based approach to assurance because we don't have the resource to do assurance over every single project that's being undertaken. We aren't going to catch everything all of the time. There will still be issues that will arise for a whole variety of different reasons. But I think that we are seeing that we are able to get in there early and we're picking more things up at an earlier stage. And we are continuously updating our review processes. We did we updated our major reviews process just recently, working with procurement colleagues, with cyber colleagues, with digital colleagues, with finance colleagues, so that we're continuously picking up on the lessons that we're learning as we do this and feeding that back into our review processes.
Okay, thank you. Willie Coffey has had to switch for technical reasons to audio only, but I'm going to go back to Willie because I think he's got further questions he wants to put.
Thanks very much. And, you know, that would happen during the discussion about ICT. But, good answers and lengthy, detailed answers there, which I really appreciate, and I heard them very clearly. But without picking out any projects individually, I think my colleague Craig Hoy might pick out a few key projects. But would you say in general, and Jeff, you talked about the benefits of good design. Clearly, if you've got good design and an agreed specification for a piece of software, you're in with a good chance, aren't you, of delivering the thing on time and on budget. Are you able to give the committee an assurance that from all the range of projects that are in there, I think over 500 was mentioned in there that are currently being worked on, are we in that good place where we know we have good design, good specifications, good skills mix in the projects that are good enough to deliver these projects that we're working on time, on budget? And would you finally say that all of the projects that we've currently got on our books are well defined and capable of being delivered on time and on budget?
That's quite a broad question. I guess I'll begin by saying that I haven't reviewed 500 projects, and so I can only speak to those which I've got direct knowledge of, and which I've seen. I guess I'd reflect on some of the challenges that we do see with individual projects. So we see the challenge of changing requirements in that as time moves on, people think differently about the objective that they're looking to secure, and that requires good program management to understand the degree to which those are reasonable adjustments to make, or you need to hold to the original requirements. As the committee has previously reflected on, we also are challenged in terms of the skills and capability, although we're doing good work to address that, and hopefully at some point during the session we'll get to talk about that. The design process is one which has been growing across the public sector over the last 3 to 4 years. And I guess as part of that, we move from this idea of doing technology projects or ICT projects to the idea that digital is one of the tools that we use when we try and reform public services. So I think while often we're talking in terms of the technology component of a public service reform being where a lot of the challenge resides, ultimately, digital is a means by which we are better able to serve the public, and so needs to be woven in with changes to how our workforce functions, how we actually how we interact with the public, what public expectations are. I think that's why I guess I'm cautious of overly attributing the change process purely to ICT or the digital component of a change process, in that in many areas, so in areas of reform that we're looking at the moment, such as education, we have changes to organisations, to the legal framework, to the expectations of the delivery mechanisms, but also changing cultural expectations as well. And within that, the digital component is one element. I would say that we're probably in a better state than we were in 2 or 3 years ago. But this is an area where we need to continue to make improvement. And I don't think I'd be satisfied to say I'm content that everything's fine, because I think that's the substance of the question. I don't think I'm at all happy to say that there will continue to be work that we can do to improve the quality and robustness of the work that we do.
But just finally, Jeff, would you give us an assurance or any kind of assurance that we're not likely to see another I6 anytime soon?
I guess that's the point at which you sort of look at your likely retirement date and think, is there likely to be one? I can give an assurance that the process that we have in place are designed such that should we have good actors and appropriate attention across the system in 100 plus organisations, that it makes it less likely that we would have such an event. But again, if you were asking for a cast iron guarantee that it won't, I think I would be reluctant to give that.
Okay. Thanks very much for that, everyone. Thanks. Back to you, convener.
Thanks, Willie. And I reflect on the fact, I think at the moment there are 5 major ICT projects that Police Scotland have got underway. So I hope that there isn't an I6 around the corner. But anyway, I'm going to go to Craig Hoy, who's got some questions to ask.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Mr. Huggins. The 2019 report suggested that a single individual be made responsible to oversee government ICT projects. And I think the government took on board that recommendation and said that they would consider it. You're the director digital. Is that your role? And if it's not, can you give us some indication of where the government's present thinking is in relation to the creation of that role?
So I think it's an interesting proposition. And I was reflective when I was rereading the 2019 report and also the report that the previous incarnation of this committee produced last March. Within accountability and how we understand these programmes of work, I think it comes back to partly my answer to Mr. Coffey, which is we don't see ICT as a thing which is separate from the delivery of good quality public services, in the same way that we don't have a single person across the Scottish Government who's responsible for the public sector workforce. In the projects and the programmes of work, we don't like to see standalone IT projects. We're looking for them to be woven into the business model of the public sector agency that's taking forward the delivery of particular services. And for that reason, I think it's entirely appropriate that accountability for individual programmes of work need to sit within the accountability structure for the wider responsibilities of such organisations, whether that's a health board or an organisation like Forestry Scotland or an agency, because that requires the person who is the accountable officer within that organisation to be thinking about digital as part of his armoury or her armoury of how they take forward change. So at the same time, the work that we did across the autumn in terms of reflecting on our connective tissue, we did identify the need to improve the work that we do in respect of what we might describe as horizontal functions. So those are functions which are common to each programme of work. So whether that's the capability to deliver, whether it's the cyber security wrapper, whether it's the process of protecting privacy and delivering GDPR. So we think that there's a role that the digital directorate, alongside other directorates such as internal audit and assurance, have got to do in raising standards generally, to give accountable officers and SROs across the organisation a better chance of being successful in the delivery of their programme. And with that, the other element also is mapping this across the different ecosystems that we operate with. So we don't have a single digital public sector ecosystem. Yeah, at an abstract level, maybe we do. But once we take a step into an area like justice, the majority of nearly all of the functionality which has been delivered in digital is been delivered by external public bodies. So the Police Scotland, the Prison Service, and the Court Service. And there, within that, the challenges for those organisations to work effectively together to common objectives in respect of protection of the public and rehabilitation of offenders. So some of the ecosystems are closer into the Scottish Government. So if we think about agriculture and rural economy. You know, the majority of the functions there actually sit within the Scottish Government or within its agencies, and there, but again, looking for that ecosystem to be working effectively, you know, with a shared set of objectives, but again, with each of the organisations within those ecosystems having their own accountability. So I think there's a real risk that should you decide to allocate all of that accountability to myself, first of all, I'd be very busy. And I would probably never sleep, but also the degree to which it means that those people who are actually closest to the action wouldn't be discharging their accountability functions in an appropriate way.
So was that quite a long way of saying the government has discounted that recommendation?
I think it's too strong to say that we've discounted it. I think what I would say is we understand the intention behind it. We understand that it identifies the need for us to give clearer direction around a number of those horizontals and improve that robustness. In some areas, I think it will take us to probably greater direction in terms of things such as architecture. But I don't think the idea that we should be divesting accountable officers who are responsible for delivering services from the digital components of that service. I think that would be a wrong step.
But just to go back to the recommendation, it wasn't necessarily to make them accountable. It was an oversight function. Don't you still think there is a need for an oversight function with a clear line of accountability?
The text of it identified it as being a single officer responsible, and that feels quite strong. That feels like an accountability. And in the context of accountability, I guess my concern is that begins to produce a confusion as to exactly who is responsible for the delivery. It also, of course, because the allocations, the money that is being used to support these digital programmes, it is coming from allocations given to individual public bodies or agencies. It's not an allocation which I hold. So the choices which are being made there, also in terms of the programmes to take forward, and be initiated, do not sit with me. And I guess the challenge of being responsible for things which I don't control is a slightly worrying idea. But as I said, I do understand the import of it, and I guess in terms of the mischief. The sense that there isn't sufficient direction, control, and orchestration. I would agree with that. And we're taking a number of steps through the digital committee and the horizontal work to address those challenges.
Okay. I saw Ms. Fairweather just nodding in agreement there. So I assume you're going to validate this position. But just from an audit and governance and accountability perspective, wouldn't it make sense to have a single figure within the government to whom, or on whose door you could knock if we had concerns about the way ICT projects were developing?
Well, I'm going to echo very much a lot of the stuff that Jeff has said, because the accountability for the delivery of public services sits with the accountable officers within the organisations responsible, and that incorporates the digital element of the delivery of those services. And they have their own assurance frameworks within each of those bodies. They have external and internal audit, and their own, and they are accountable to Parliament for the delivery of those public services. So it's right that the digital element of those services sits with them too. We work closely with Jeff's team and the public bodies that we provide an internal audit service over, but I would expect to be looking at the individual bodies and their accountability for their projects within those bodies first and foremost, and then we will work with the Scottish Government on, as Jeff puts it, the horizontal themes and the lessons learned, and ensuring that all those structures and processes are in place to support as good a delivery as possible. But I think the key point for me here is the point that Jeff's making around the fact that IT is an enabler. It's very difficult to extract from some of the delivery of improving public services the IT element from all of the rest of it. It's all got to be part of the whole in order to deliver that change in service.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Huggins, I think Mr. Coffey referred to this in terms of the major projects that are currently underway, which are critical to the delivery of the digital strategy. And are there any at this point in time that are giving you any further sleepless nights?
So the particular major projects referred to in the digital strategy, there's generally focus on those areas, the area that we've described as common platforms. So for me, that's the work on the use of cloud infrastructure the work on identity and the work on payments. Each of those sits within and sits within my responsibilities as well. So, you know, as a consequence, they're more likely to keep me awake at night. The broader strategy just, you know, talks about a number of different areas, but doesn't have a particular focus on any particular major projects as they sit within other strategies, whether that's health and care or justice or education. In terms of the focus around the areas where digital directorate is in the lead and for which I'm accountable, we've done some work since the summer of last year to reorganise and address how we deliver these programmes. In terms of payments, we made the first run of payments using the Scottish Government's payment platform in December, which is a key milestone for the delivery of a programme. So we made a payments run for the Independent Living Fund, and we would expect that by the time we get into the summer, that will be the mechanism by which payments for the Independent Living Fund are made. In terms of the work, and so that's a programme of work which is clearly working its way through the process of MVP to alpha to beta and into live service. It's going to be quite an interesting change for us because, with the exception of some of the work that we do around publishing through MyGov and the work there, this takes the Scottish Government into delivering a live technology service being supplied to more than one, but by the time we get to that stage, external public bodies who will then rely on it. So it takes, you know, my team into having to build a new set of skills in terms of the robustness and ongoing management of technology. It brings us into commercial models. And so we're going through the process at the moment of effectively building a series of new skills and teams within the directorate to be able to accommodate that. And alongside that, we then have the work on identity. And identity is a key concept in terms of digital technology. The idea that I can demonstrate to a body that I'm me, and that I can use that identity then to do things such as make a payment, access a service. It's a complex technology. The UK government and other European nations are working on it. We're talking to colleagues from Denmark and Estonia who've also taken forward programmes of work in that area. But over the last four or five months, we've made significant progress in terms of that work in relation to the delivery of a single sign-on product, which is a first step. And as we go into the second half of this year, we'll be looking at attribute stores. So quite a lot of change to make the programme considerably more robust. A review also of the programme management and the programme governance for each of the projects. The third, I guess, on my list that I would mention is the work in respect of cloud services and cloud infrastructure, and you know, this is an enabler of an enabler. As we step into the next period of time, you know, we'd anticipate that most public services will run on cloud. They won't run on more traditional on-premise services, and as part of that, what we've seen over the last couple of years is each organisation, as they make that journey, having to go out and build some of the core infrastructure, you know, not directly, quite often through third parties. And the core infrastructure is pretty common. It's the sort of thing that, having done it once, you should use it many times. It also allows us to think about how we bring it within our sort of cyber shield as well, if we're doing it in a common way. And if we do it in a common way, it makes it more predictable, makes it less likely to fail. So the programme of work there is it's slightly more mixed than the other two in that it's both developing the conceptual model for how we take that forward, but also some of the core infrastructure around account management, you know, FinOps, because cloud, notoriously, cloud is a service that you pay for on the basis of consumption. So how you architect particular technology will affect how much it costs to run. At different times, all of these programmes of work keep me awake at night. But at the same time, as of the end of March, I feel considerably more comfortable than maybe I did in the summer of last year, just about the skills, capability and work that's going on there.
OK, and just in terms of comfort, can you perhaps provide the committee with an update on how the social security software components are progressing?
So I think it's been a really interesting programme of work. It's a major technology investment and transformation programme. They're currently in the first phase of the adult disability benefit payment, having launched the child disability payment at the end of last year. And you know that takes them to effectively 9 out of 10 major benefits that they're looking to bring across. They've clearly learned and iterated and applied a lot of the design that we would expect to see, as well as building very modern infrastructure. Which is the sort of infrastructure that we would expect to see. I sit on their program board and meet with their senior technology leader on a regular basis. So I've got good visibility of that program. And again, that's probably a good example of how we work across the Scottish Government to build confidence in the work that's going on. But you know, it's been a major undertaking, which has gone I would say remarkably well, and is a testament to all of those who've been involved in the work. It's interesting because the capability that they've then built over the last 7 or 8 years to build the system, and I think I was on the programme board as far back as 2017, so having seen it at the start, seeing it now is just as interesting. That's a capability that will begin to become available to other programmes of work, you know, as they move into a business as usual model, and they move away from the very significant development phase that they've been going through. So I'm hoping that by the time we get into 2024, they'll be offering me technologists, service designers, user researchers that I can deploy across other programmes of work.
Okay. And just if I can close just by looking at financial controls and prioritisation of spend. Obviously, I think the Enabling Digital Government Audit Scotland report highlighted there's no complete picture of the number and cost of digital projects across the public sector. And I think in response to the previous committee's report in March 2021, the Scottish Government said that it was about to implement a new spending controls process. Could you perhaps bring us up to date on that and where the government's present thinking is in relation to IT prioritisation control and spend?
So that programme of work, I think it's a really interesting and quite challenging programme of work. And I guess two or three things to say at the beginning. First of all, we're being very careful to ensure that it's not simply another layer which replicates something which is happening through the digital assurance process, which we already have. So it needs to add a different value as opposed to being a further process that people go through. And so we've spent time over the autumn and into this year looking at the interaction between those different processes such that we can then explain how they cumulatively add value and how they're not duplication. So we're doing that piece of work. We're also conscious again that applying a control through a process such as this, how that then also interacts with accountable officer and senior responsible officer responsibilities. And what that takes us to is an approach which is focused on identifying and highlighting and escalating risks into the accountability space to look for an appropriate response, mitigation or change of direction or however within that process, but again, not looking to dilute the accountable officer responsibility. In terms of the practicalities, we've done quite an analysis of how we spend money on digital, which looks beyond and maybe it takes us a sort of what we might describe as a sideways look, but actually by actually going through and tagging, and at times this can be difficult to do accurately, where money has gone on digital, whether that's on contingent staff, whether it's on consumables, whether it's on contracts and procurements, and to understand that. And that's looking, instead of looking down the individual programmes, that's looking almost sideways into the budget. And it's given us, I guess, quite a set of interesting challenges in terms of, you know, if an area struggles to recruit and then takes on contingent labour or contractor labour, the additional costs in that space. But then if that's equally a challenge, the next stage potentially to go to an external managed contract, then becomes a further cost. And those things tend to be not that visible within the process of looking at individual programmes of work in terms of understanding those dynamics. So we're working through how we understand how money is used as part of the process. In terms of the practical application, we've agreed that we will pilot that, and in the interests of fairness and transparency, we've decided to apply it to me first, for reasons that you know, I guess it's the eat your own dog food, and take the learning. So I guess I was keen that we would experience exactly what it felt like to be subject to spend controls, and we're looking at two or three programmes of work that sit on the. In respect of the government's internal technology, so some of the processes that we're doing around things such as telephony, and you know, the evolution of that over the next period of time, effectively to say, so if we take this framework which has been developed and apply it, how does that actually operate in practice? A further thing I think to reflect on is, in terms of applying spend control, it suggests that we have a knowledge of what we might expect to find. In respect of a particular type of programme. And so the work that we're doing on component-based architecture and architectural principles, as well as you know, capability, as well as design, you know, each of those then becomes very relevant to spend controls process, so that if we're making an assessment, it isn't just an individual's view. It's not just I'm a professional, I think you should do it this way. To actually have a consensus as to what you might expect to find for an individual programme. And I think... So that's still developing work, and with particular structures being put in place to actually create some of those effectively agreed frameworks for how we do things. But I think that's probably where I would say we are at this stage. So we're in a test period developing some of the artifacts that sit around it, but conscious of how it fits into the broader ecosystem of governance and control.
Okay, just one final specific question on a specific project, if I may. You mentioned earlier the COVID status app as an example of the agility of the government IT process and the procurement process, I'm assuming, as well. Just to interrogate maybe that dynamic of how the spending control process actually works in practice, I think the initial estimate for that project was something in the region of £600,000, and it ended up at £7 million, is my understanding from recent media coverage. How would the spending control process during a project like that would work? I'm not sure if that even counts, that level of spend, as a major ICT project, but just to understand how a project like that evolves and what spending control mechanisms are in place.
Yeah, I haven't seen the financials. I think in terms of the particular programme of work, and I guess it's one of those, you know, the componentry that goes into that programme, one of the key elements of it is the validation of identity, you know, and in respect of the programme of work itself, what we can see is that particular process by which, you know, when you signed up for the app, which I'm presuming you did, that you were validated, and that involved identification, the tying of you, your identity to a particular set of data on the vaccination database. And that went through a process which is, if I understand it correctly, requires a one-to-one matching of you with your data through the Jumio product. And this is a challenge we have equally with identity. And that effectively has a component cost. And you know, I'm guessing, based on markets, it'll probably be somewhere between £1 and £2 to actually sort of do that match, because that's the, you know, there's a market. It's on the UK government contract framework for those services. So each time that somebody signed up, and 2.5 million people signed up for that, there would have been a cost of somewhere between £1 and £2 going into that, which I guess probably wasn't contemplated at the beginning as being a component of the cost of the project. But again, it's not a project which I've got direct responsibility for, but I guess it shows how it's something which you hadn't anticipated you were going to need to do. becomes a cost.
That presumably talks to the point that maybe the control mechanisms still need to be tightened up within government.
I think that probably comes back to a design issue. But with fairness, the programme itself and the urgency with which the programme was being taken forward probably takes it into a slightly different box. Yeah, that's, I would say, if with my identity programme, which is going to require a similar type of service, if in 2 years' time you're asking me why did it cost three times as much and I say it's because I didn't quite realise I was going to have to pay for identity services, I think I'd look a bit daft, you know, because it, you know, I've got the time to work through that and to budget for that appropriately.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thanks. One of the reasons why this committee has had an interest down the years in major ICT projects is because there have been some fairly notorious cost overruns and failed applications, whether it is NHS 24 or the Scottish Public Pensions Agency, the CAP Futures programme, and the already mentioned police I6 project. And I just want to go back to what you were saying about there's an already existing structure of accountable officers. I mean, this committee has previously said that there needs to be a much firmer grip taken of this and much clearer lines of responsibility. So if I take, as I understand it, Police Scotland, you know, Police Scotland, when I read the list of ICT projects, have got, I think, five or six on at the moment, five anyway, Unified Communications and Contact Platform, Digital Evidence Sharing Capability, National Integrated Command and Control System, Core Operational Solutions, Mobile Working, different projects. Who's got oversight of those?
So those programmes will appear on our list and they'll be subject to the assurance processes that that are taken forward through gateway reviews. But the accountability for those programmes sits with the accountable officers within Police Scotland and the SPA. And that's appropriate because these are mechanisms by which they discharge their functions of delivering a police service. They're not an IT company, they're not a technology company, but they are required to build that into their process of delivering the service that they do. So it sits with them.
So what's different now to the position as was when the I6 project was underway?
So I think there's a number of things which are different and a number of things which are changing. So first of all, we've got better knowledge of why things don't work and lessons are being applied and lessons are being have been learnt. We have a greater attention to the capability, but also to digital leadership within organisations. So one of the key objectives that we have over the next 12 months is to increase the number of senior people across the public sector who are effectively digital professionals. So to move it from being, you know, at a lower level within organisations with digital services being managed by generalists, to increase the visibility of digital leaders in each of our organisations, and that includes the Scottish Government. During this year, we will run a deputy director board to effectively establish a number of digital and data and technology professional deputy directors so that they can sit within other portfolios and bring that knowledge and understanding of programmes of work. Elevating that digital leadership component with the objective that they're part of SMTs, senior management teams across the organisation. So that knowledge, capability and leadership, I think, is core. Alongside that, we then have things such as leading in a digital world, which is working with both people working in the digital space, but other leaders, you know, which is the Scottish Digital Academy's work to increase knowledge and understanding of digital programmes of work. And that extends beyond the design components and those elements into understanding governance and control and process and understanding what can go wrong and what has gone wrong. So there's a number of things which are in place. I think the bigger set of changes, though, are those work on horizontals, you know, whether they are through better assurance, better compliance, but also understanding the implications of running services directly, because increasingly we are digital organisations. You know, if you go back 10, 15 years, we weren't digital organisations. We maybe had third parties who did digital things for us, but now it makes no sense for us not to see ourselves effectively as a digital organisation.
Okay, well, I think we may have a session in the future where we drill a bit more deeply into some of these individual ICT projects. But I'm going to, in the interest of time, apart from anything else, I'm going to hand over to Colin Beattie, who's got a number of questions to ask.
Thank you, Convener. Just building a little bit on what the Convener's been talking about, over the past 11 years in this committee, I've seen a whole progression of ICT projects which have failed or failed to deliver what was expected and in some cases were abandoned. We've had responsible officers, accountable officers in front of us here. We got assurances that there was an acceptance that the accountable officers did not have the skills necessarily to manage these projects and that within the organisations there was a lack of end-user understanding of how to interface with the technical experts that were building the programme. And again, that has created unwarranted optimism, followed by, of course, dismay when what's delivered does not comply with what they were looking for. The response over a period of years was for layers of management to be thrown in centrally. And at one point, it was actually quite bewildering trying to understand which layer did what. Now, I'm assuming from what you're saying that's now resolved itself somewhat. But I don't understand where the change is. We've still got the accountable officers being accountable for the projects. The idea was that there would be a central capacity created to provide them with support, to help them identify providers, to help them as end users to gain the skills and so on that were necessary to ensure these projects delivered actually what they were supposed to do. And, you know, we received all these assurances. I'm not clear from what you're saying whether all these assurances have actually been delivered, and I'd be interested in getting a little more information around that.
Yeah, so I guess there's a couple of elements there. So the work that we've been doing through the Digital Transformation Service is probably key to this, and it's one of the divisions within my directorate which has a focus on how public sector agencies and public bodies work their way through the change process. Now, it tends to be not the mega bodies. It tends to be the one, you know, which quite often are well resourced and have available digital resources internally and externally. But the Digital Transformation Service is focused on effectively delivering support in a number of ways. So it hosts the Digital Commercial Service, which is a joint piece of work between myself and the Director of Procurement, Nick Ford, within the Scottish Government, which looks at how we buy things and how we manage contracts effectively. In terms of assuring ourselves that we're buying things the way we should buy them, with a sense of surety as to what we deliver, it also then hosts the design capability within the directorate, which is working through how organisations work through the user-centred design process, but also apply items such as accessibility and those elements which are core to what we do. Alongside the work of the platforms division, it's also then working with the process of beginning to scope out the public sector architecture and the componentry. And, you know, we've recently used the Digital Fellowship Programme to bring in a senior chief architect. And that will effectively also operate as a sub-board to the Digital Committee. And that's basically saying what a programme of work, how it should be architected if it's to give a greater likelihood of success. And then we've got the work on the profession and capability, which is taken taken forward by a separate division. In terms of the orchestration of those different elements, which go to giving a better chance and opportunity of a successful programme of work, that's part of the change that we've put in place and which we're continuing to take forward. But also understanding that effectively in itself is also a service. So understanding what our community of, you know, what other organisations need and what the best way to provide that to them is. Because it's, you know, the experience is it's not simply running seminars, providing guidance, telling people what to do, in that quite often that takes organisations and people to a particular point. But the next stage is the question, so how do we apply this knowledge within our context, is the question that we also often get. And that takes us to a process which is a bit closer and a bit more engaged in that. So that functional capability from within the directorate is intended to address some of that. But to be fair, it's more likely to apply to medium and smaller public bodies. You know, the larger public bodies like the NHS or Police Scotland are at a scale where they have their own digital departments and their own digital agencies within them. So it operates in different ways.
But even these departments, you talk about the police, talk about the NHS, they have their own digital people, but they've still got projects that failed, and they failed because the skills weren't there to manage the contract. I mean, even the contract negotiation has been an issue with some of these. How are we providing them the support on this? From what I can understand from what's being said, the individual accountable officers within whose areas these projects might fall would still have the final say in how that project is managed. Or do you have the authority to overrule them if you feel that they're going adrift?
So there's a set of arrangements in place in respect of how we procure within the digital space, and the procurement aspect of this is handled by the Director of Procurement, using the frameworks which we have in place to purchase things and the processes that we apply through the procurement process. And those are robust. The area that we've then developed over the last 12 months is to increase the support in respect of contract management, because often things go wrong after you've procured, to ensure that there are robust arrangements in place to manage people who've sold us things or are selling us things as an ongoing service, to understand the tools and techniques and approaches and, you know, the documentation and the review that we would expect to see as part of good contract management. So that's an area which has been strengthened through the creation of that additional function between, as I said, myself and the Director of Procurement. So we have each of those elements. The challenge is that there are many reasons why a programme of work may fail. And often those reasons, you know, are not current reasons, they're historic reasons. It was maybe, the model or the approach was never going to have success. The demand for the service, which people thought was there, maybe wasn't there, and that's a common challenge across governments across the world, to build services that people simply don't use. But again, the processes of increasing the use of design, testing, MVP, and piloting projects is part of the process of reducing the number of failures.
But most of the projects that we've seen fail have failed not because they were delivering something that the public didn't want. They eventually delivered something that the department or division concerned didn't expect. And it was a case of interpretation between the end users and the techies building the system. Because that is vital, that there's an understanding between the two. And yet again and again, what's being delivered is less than was expected, different from what was expected, unable to be used for one reason or another. Now, out of all this, I would have expected a stronger central support. We talk about contracts. Each individual accountable officer surely doesn't have to be trained in the intricacies of a contract to build a new software system. Surely that is the sort of thing that could be centralised, and you'd have experts going through that and making sure that all the safeguards are there. I mean, we've seen systems built that just had no safeguards in at all. There was no penalties on deliveries and all sorts of things that are basic. Surely that's the sort of thing that could be centralised usefully and helpfully.
So I think the challenge is that once you begin to unpick the components of a programme and ascribe elements of that programme to a central function, you know, the degree to which accountability becomes tangled. And I guess maybe to take a step back and to think about why programmes succeed rather than why programmes fail. So Mr. Hoy asked about the Social Security Agency. So the Social Security Scotland have in place very robust governance arrangements for their programme of work, which the accountable officer is directly involved in on a regular basis, with a clearly appointed SRO supported by technical capability to execute both in terms of the technology, the design and the business and commercial aspects. And they will then also work with my colleagues and with Nick Ford's colleagues in procurement in terms of understanding the wider dynamics. And so they'll take some support, but within their programme of work, they're assuring themselves that the money that they're spending has been used wisely. I guess it's that element of understanding the ingredients that you need to put together within the delivery of a major programme is the learning which is being applied through things such as gateway reviews, which do look at the outset as to the question, are the resources here to make this, give this a chance of successful execution in place?
Now, earlier you said that you're expecting technical expertise to reside within the different areas for the accountable officer would be able to access that expertise internally within his area. Again and again, what's come to light is there is not enough technical expertise in the market. There is a huge shortage, and Scotland's not alone in that. The last estimate I saw, which is several years ago, there was 300,000 short across Europe. Now, it's big numbers, and those that are available are demanding salaries which are way above the normal scales, and they were being paid off scale at one point to try and get them in. So is it realistic to expect that each area is going to be able to recruit at some considerable expense this sort of skill to enable them to build a contract? Or wouldn't it make more sense for it to be available centrally to give that support in a rather more cohesive way?
So it's interesting that we came to that conclusion last year in respect of recruitment of digital professionals. And on the basis of that, we developed a proposition under which we would create a separate digital recruitment function sitting between myself and People Directorate within the Scottish Government, focused purely on bringing technical expertise into initially the Scottish Government, but over time the wider public sector, understanding the dynamics of that market. Digital professionals have got skills which enable them to work where they wish and to work on the projects that they want to work on. And as a consequence of that, they tend to move more frequently. So our model of the person who joins government for life doesn't apply to digital professionals. So we need a way of thinking within that under which we're continually recruiting. Even if we don't have a vacancy for a programme delivery manager in digital, we should be recruiting for those because we know in 6 weeks' time we'll need one. So we have agreement to put in place a new service which will launch during this year, which will focus and use the techniques which are being used externally by private sector agencies to recruit digital talent, which understands how people in that space apply and where they expect, how they expect to interact with the recruitment process. They don't expect a traditional governmental approach. I recall recruiting in the NHS a couple of years ago, and somebody wrote on their application form, "I'll tell you at interview," for each of the questions, declined to enumerate any of their competences or skills. What that meant was we had to work with candidates who we thought were credible to enable them to apply so that we could assess them fairly. We needed to, to some degree, bring them into our world. So we will have a new process of bringing that skill into government. In terms of values and salaries, at the moment, in terms of, we're doing some work at the moment on that in the context of the review of DDAT allowances, and what that shows us is we're not uncompetitive. And there's a real risk that government, as it accelerates and puts more money into the digital area, begins to distort the market, just simply because of the demand. And effectively, if we do that, we push up the cost of all programmes of work. But our salaries are not uncompetitive for most roles, although we will struggle to pick up particular skill sets in the areas of things such as cyber, where those are like gold dust across the system. So again, understanding the process by which we recruit in terms of the dynamics of those who we're looking to bring into this sector. My experience is also that there are many from the private sector who would very happily come and join the public sector. They are looking because they are people who are motivated by interesting things to do. Some may be motivated by money. We probably don't want them, but the chance to build a new social security system, to assist with helping Ukrainian refugees come to Scotland, to addressing things such as the a national care service. These are the really exciting programmes and projects of our age. And while some may be excited by selling holidays or social media or things like that, the opportunities to change the world or be involved in that process are, we haven't sold ourselves that way. So we've a number of measures in place which are particularly designed at increasing the capability, and that is one area where we see value, because in the absence of that, each different area is competing with each other different area for the same talent.
Looking back at previous ICT projects that have failed, almost invariably where an NDPB is involved, you've got an IT failure. That's what we've seen historically. How do you provide them with support? How do you ensure that that they're not just going off on their own and creating rubbish, which is in some cases what's happened in the past?
So, bring in Sharon Fairweather at this point, because I think you've been meaning to get in.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
It's not that I don't like listening to Jeff, because he's a really interesting person to talk to, but...
yes, and we are getting tight for time now, but
So there are a couple of things. First of all, we obviously talk to every NDPB on a six-monthly basis about the projects, and they come onto our project register. So we know from an early stage the projects that they're involved in, and we then get involved with them right from that start and doing the risk assessment around the level of assurance that they need on those projects. And a couple of points that I wanted to make. So within the technology assurance framework has developed in recent years, some of it as a consequence of things like CAP futures programs, etc. So some of the programs that you were talking about that failed, we've put in significant new assurance structures since then and have continuously developed them further from the lessons that we've learned from those types of programs. And I think we have to bear in mind some of that historical timeline of some of the projects that you've been mentioning. In the period that the Technology Assurance Framework has been running, we've done over 300 reviews on major projects on digital standards. Now, that's not 300 projects, because some projects have more than one review. But because we've been doing it at various stages, we've been able to catch, as we've said earlier, issues earlier in those projects. And there haven't been 300 or 150 or even 50 projects that have failed through that have come forward. There have been some significant projects that have failed that have come forward. But I think that we're seeing more and more that the lessons from those project failures are being built into the assurance frameworks and are being caught earlier within projects now. Now, we've said earlier, we can't give you assurance that there won't be another project failure. None of us would be can do that. But I think that we are seeing a continuous improvement in the way that projects are being delivered. We know some of the areas, like you say, that we need to look out for, and capability and capacity of digital resources is one of them that we see often. But I think we're beginning to catch some of that at an earlier stage. And just one other thing I wanted to say, Mr. Beattie, was that within the Technology Assurance Framework, we do have the option to stop a project. If we think that it is going seriously off the scales, we do have the option to stop a project. So that is in place if it's needed.
You're the time convener, I'll pass it back to you.
Okay, right. Well, thank you very much indeed. And can I thank this morning's witnesses for their evidence? There are some things that I think we probably will be keen to pursue. And as I mentioned earlier on, I think we are hoping to have a session probably with the accountable officers over some particular projects which have exercised our interest. But can I thank Jeff Huggins, Johnny Ruff, Sharon Fairweather and Donald McGilvery for coming along and presenting yourselves before us this morning. It's appreciated. I will now draw this meeting into a suspension while we change over witnesses. Thank you. Can I resume this morning's meeting and turn to the next item on our agenda, which is a look at the briefing that was produced by Audit Scotland recently on drug and alcohol services, which was really an update report on some work that Audit Scotland have looked at over a decade or more. We are joined this morning in the committee room by Stephen Boyle, the Auditor General. Welcome. Anthony Clark, who's the Interim Director of Performance Audit and Best Value, and by Gillian Matthew, who's a Senior Manager at Audit Scotland. What I'd like to do in this session, Auditor General, is to invite you to make an opening statement, and then we will we'll ask a series of questions that we've got on the briefing. Over to you.
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, everybody. Convener, today I'm bringing to the committee a briefing on drug and alcohol services. Our paper updates our earlier work from, as you note, from 2009 and 2019. 3 years ago, we highlighted that drug and alcohol-related deaths and associated ill health remained high in Scotland. Problem drug and alcohol use is closely linked to deprivation, and ministers have described Scotland's drug deaths as an emergency, with the country having the highest drug-related death rate in Europe. The number of people dying from alcohol has also been increasing, and excess alcohol consumption similarly causes wider societal and health harms. My joint briefing with the Accounts Commission provides a further update on the key challenges and areas for improvement, which we plan to follow up in more detail next year. Progress in addressing the challenges has been slow since our 2009 report, where we have seen the Scottish Government and their partners increase their focus and efforts in recent years. We highlight a number of new developments, such as the Drug Death Task Force, new medication assisted treatment standards, and efforts to improve access to residential rehabilitation. This has been accompanied by a significant increase in funding in the last 2 years, after a period of reduced funding and no real terms increase. However, it's not yet clear what impact these new approaches and increased investment are having. Our paper also highlights that the delivery of drug and alcohol services is complex, with clearer accountability needed. There are many organisations working across different sectors, and governance is complicated and difficult to navigate. More focus is therefore needed on prevention and tackling inequalities. Spending could be more effectively targeted at interventions tackling the root cause of drug addiction in communities, but the Scottish Government has not yet identified what level of investment is required to achieve the greatest benefits. We're calling on the Scottish Government to join up the various strands of work and funding streams to show how it is collectively targeting improved outcomes. The Government now needs an overarching plan that clearly links spending to reducing this tragic loss of life. And in the longer term, more focus is needed on policies that tackle inequalities and the root of drug and alcohol misuse. Convener, as ever, between Anthony, Gillian and myself, we'll look to answer the committee's questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed for that opening statement. The very first lines of the briefing are a stark reminder of the situation we find ourselves in. I mean, the very first sentence in the briefing is, in Scotland, 1,339 people died from drug-related causes in 2020, the highest ever reported and the highest rate in Europe. And yet, as you've just said in your opening remarks, progress, as you view it, has been slow. In this report, you once again describe a lack of drive and leadership by the Scottish Government. I mean, to what extent can you tell us, did the Scottish Government respond to the recommendations, very clear recommendations, that you made over a decade ago in 2009?
Thank you, Convener. I'll bring colleagues in to support some of the detail in the 2009 report, but what we look to do in today's briefing paper is really to update on both the 2009 and the 2019 report and to signal our intention to undertake further work in an area of real significance. The ministers have been very clear in their assessment that this is a national emergency. Some of the statistics which underpin real life, you know, circumstances, individuals, families, and communities, and some of the very stark numbers before us. So in terms of the tracking the progress over the years, we note in the report that the arrangements that Scotland has to deliver drugs and alcohol services remain complex and fragmented. Some of the governance arrangements are also difficult to navigate. It's not clear what the most targeted, successful funding delivers in terms of improved outcomes. There have been many initiatives that have taken place. You know, going back to the alcohol and drug partnerships that date around the time of the publication of our report as a means of delivering more local targeted strategies. It's similarly not clear that the overall benefit that such structures are delivering across Scotland. So 13 years later, we're still as a country facing some really dreadful statistics in terms of the delivery of outcomes for problem drug and alcohol usage. And that's why we've arrived at the point today of, in spite of recognising the progress that has taken place in very recent years, with additional significant funding commitments planned over the life of this parliamentary term, that the call for an overarching plan that sets out what's the most successful interventions, what's evidence that supports that those that lead to better outcomes, and that that plan is clear, transparent, is measurable, and the governance and arrangements that take place across the country support the delivery of improved services. Kavira, I'll pause for a moment, actually, and maybe invite Gillian and perhaps Anthony also just to say a bit more about the trajectory over the past 12 years, if they wish.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I think, as the Auditor General says in his opening statement, the progress has been slow, but I think we have seen a lot more developments and progression over the last couple of years. But as we say in the briefing, it's still a bit early to tell the impact some of these new initiatives have had. But things like around some of the data and information systems, as we see in other reports as well, there's still gaps around that, and we've seen delays in the drug and alcohol information system known as DAISY. There's been quite significant delays around that, which has been designed to help ADPs in local areas, the alcohol and drug partnerships in local areas, really kind of see how they're managing people with drug and alcohol use and measure progress, look at activity. There's still quite a few gaps around the information that's needed to do that well. We know that they're currently working on trying to improve information around rehabilitation services as well, which is obviously a priority area for the Scottish Government. And along with that, you know, as we've seen, that the investment in drug and alcohol services reduced around 2016-17, and we didn't really see any, there was a cash increase, but not a real terms increase really until 2021. And now there's been, you know, much more significant investment. But again, that's, you know, relatively recently. But we still don't know how that's been directed, not fully. You know, as we say, we need more information around details around the spending. We haven't been able to track that fully. And how much of that is actually directed towards prevention and what the different strands of funding, how they're helping to improve outcomes and deliver some of the priorities that the government has set. We've still not got a clear picture about how all that links together.
Thank you. And we've got further questions about the transparency of spending and governance arrangements and the strategy to come. But I've just got one other question which I wanted to put to you, which was, when I look at Exhibit 1 in the briefing, it describes how over time alcohol-related deaths reduced and levelled off over a period of 15 years, but then have started to rise again. So my question is, in your opinion, what are the measures which drove down that decline in alcohol-related deaths? And what, in your assessment, may be the cause of the recent increase?
I think, to be clear, Convener, I'm not sure we're necessarily able to attribute with any great confidence the factors behind the movements that you identify in Exhibit 1 in respect of alcohol-related deaths. As ever, there are many complex factors behind usage of alcohol, and we know that there have been policy interventions, particularly, I think, as we touch on in the briefing paper, the introduction of minimum unit pricing for alcohol. What we're not doing in this paper is drawing that direct explanation into why the alcohol-related deaths have dropped as such. It's our intention to track government's analysis and review Public Health Scotland's role in doing so and undertake further work. We also speculate, Convener, if I may say, in the briefing paper about the impact that the pandemic has had and the potential implications of increased alcohol usage through over the course of the past 2 years as ever, that would just be just that, convener speculation. So we know that there are many various factors, but it's our intention to follow up further work, but we're probably restricted in our ability to be definitive what we think are the root causes behind that number.
Yeah, we understand that, and I think that would be helpful to return to that. I guess one of the overarching questions that come out of the briefing, and that many people looking at this whole area of public policy ask, is whilst there are new initiatives taking place now, why has it taken so long, given that you were evaluating this all those years ago, back in 2009, during which time things haven't got better, they've got worse?
Yeah, that's certainly one of our conclusions in the briefing paper, convener, that progress has been slow. The reasons behind that, you know, I think, and exploration of it, if should the committee so wish to do, I think, are valid with government and their partners as to why progress didn't move on as anticipated. But I think that what we look to do is identify some of the reasons behind why progress hasn't been. So we're still identifying, as I've touched on, some of the governance arrangements feeling complex, a lack of clear transparency around some of the funding environment with which drugs and alcohol services are delivered, but also the reduction in funding that we note in the paper too, that funding dropped from 2016-17 onwards, as Gillian mentions, has returned to those anticipated growth levels in cash terms, and the government has very significant plans over the life of this parliamentary term and some of the interventions, emergency interventions, and more longer-term planned recovery arrangements, some of the rehabilitation services that they are supporting. What we effectively say is it's too early yet to tell how significant, how beneficial those interventions will be. But it's vitally important, though, that government has an evidence base with which to make informed policy decisions in the future. We're keen not to prepare another report like we've done in recent years, convener, that talks about slow progress, and keen to see that some of the interventions, the value for money behind some of these really critical steps are taken.
OK, thank you. I'm going to invite Craig Hoy to ask a series of questions. Craig.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Mr. Boyle. One of the key measures and policies taken by the Scottish Government has been the introduction of new medication-assisted treatment standards, MAT standards, which has become a bit of a buzzword. Your briefing, I think, rightly notes that these standards are aiming to give people access, choice and support through drug services. Now, they're due to be embedded across the country by April 2022, which, as we know, is this week. So just wondering if you provide some update on where you believe that to be and how realistic is this deadline of April 2022?
Yeah, thanks, Kavir. I'm going to turn to Gillian, actually, just to update the committee on this point.
Yeah, I think as far as we know, that's on track. We were sort of liaising with the government around, obviously, our report and some of the key findings. So that was confirmed to be on track.
Of looking at one of the other key innovations and developments, it was the creation of a drug death task force in Scotland. And the task force, both the chair and the deputy chair, the original chair and deputy chair, both resigned, citing serious concerns that the pace that the task force was being asked to operate at would risk the implementation of sustainable change. Effectively, they were saying that speed does not equate to effectiveness. Do you share these concerns that after a period of inactivity, perhaps we're mistaking activity with making progress?
So we note the circumstances of the resignation of the chair and deputy chair in the briefing paper and the subsequent appointment of a new chair and deputy chair. I think there are a number of related points in our own paper. So we do talk about the slow progress in our own paper. The need for an overarching, clear, transparent plan, measurable, sets out the impact of different levels of investment, as we've touched on already this morning, the very significant planned increase in government funding. And as ever, Mr. Hoy, in this paper, as we do in many of our reports, unfortunately, talk about the lack of high-quality data with which to measure progress. All of these things need to be in place so that as we move into over the life of this parliamentary term, what feels like a step change in plan and focus around drugs and alcohol, that's delivered to best effect. So I think that's probably what I would finish by saying is I recognise the conflict between pace and the needing to have a clear, measurable, deliverable plan. And we look forward to seeing in an effect of our own recommendation that a new overarching plan captures not just the work of the Drug Deaths Task Force, but also the earlier strategy for rights, respect and recovery, and the national mission, that they're all gathered up on a measurable, clear, deliverable plan.
Matthew slightly preempted me in relation to the considerable delays in the implementation of the Drug and Alcohol Information System, DAISY, and that database. There are still, I think, considerable data gaps within the system. So could you perhaps just give some elaboration on the work that's currently underway to address those gaps, and what sort of timescale are we operating to in order to try and make sure that we get this important information into the system?
Yeah, so we did speak to some of the team at Public Health Scotland that are working on this, and you know, it's clear there's still a lot of work to do. Some of that is related to the quality and availability of data coming from the ADPs themselves. Okay. So I think, you know, locally there's work done around that, but also at the national level there's developments around the data that's required, and I think some of that's still being worked through, reflecting some of the more recent initiatives that have been announced, so the national mission. So I think the original plan for DAISY has evolved over time, and you're having to take into account some of these new strategies and making sure that the data is there to kind of, you know, to answer some of the questions around that, or you know, to measure performance and progression. So one main area that there's a focus on at the moment is around residential rehabilitation services, and there's been some recent reports around that, and there's a lot of work to do around the activity, the, you know, the sort of pathways, how many places, all that kind of thing, you know, to really build up the full picture around what's available, and then also, you know, the government are looking at increasing capacity. So I think there's quite a bit of work to be done around that, and I think other pieces of work as well. That was the main area that they talked about, but they did recognise there were still gaps in other areas. I mean, we talked about homelessness people being very vulnerable, but things like some of these wider or, you know, like sort of other services aren't all quite joined up yet. Mm. So, you know, I think there's a recognition that there's still quite a few gaps, but it's going to be sort of an incremental approach to building all that into the system. But because there's already been so many delays, it's still, you know, trying to get that in place, and as I say, the quality of data as well from the local partnerships.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Ball, just finally, your 2019 update referred to or questioned the appropriateness of a 21-day waiting time target for drug and alcohol treatment. I think you also raised some quite serious concerns about do not attends, people who effectively fall out of the system, and particularly in relation to drug deaths, people who have had no contact whatsoever with the treatment. Are you aware of any work currently being undertaken or any ongoing work within the Scottish Government to try and address these two critical issues?
Yeah, I'll turn to Gillian again, see if she has an update on the government's plans around these points. But just for completeness, Mr. Moore, you're absolutely right. We noted in the 2019 report that the extent to which the 21-day target was appropriate given some of the urgency of the circumstances that problem drug users might be facing, their ability to engage in services as well at key emergency points in their lives. And all of that kind of was the root of our recommendation to take stock as to whether those measures were actually productive and we're helping what felt like a really acute set of circumstances. But I'll just check with the team for any more information. If we don't, we can come back in writing.
Before you answer, Matt, I'd just quickly comment on a broader point, which is I think the issue around the 28-day waiting target speaks to a broader issue about capacity in the system. It seems to me the issue there was people having too long to wait to access the services that they need at a time of crisis. And the investments and the commitments that are being made at the moment around building capacity are hopefully seeking to address that.
Okay.
One would assume that as part of those developments, one would think about the appropriateness of the length of time one has to wait to access services. I'm not sure whether that discussion is taking place within government. Julie may be able to answer that one. And on the DNA point, it's very clear, I think, from what we hear from ADPs, that there is still a challenge around people falling out of contact with the system. And that seems, I think, to speak to the cultural issue around the need to engage and commit and work with people when they're going through difficult circumstances in their life. And it's why the whole issue of fairness and respect has been quite an important part of the conversation around changing the culture around drug and alcohol support for individuals.
Yeah, just to add to that, around DNAs, I mean, that's another area where there isn't regular data collection or reporting. Okay. I think when we looked at that last time, there'd been a one-off exercise to try and assess what that looked like. But there is, I mean, the government have announced a new target, which I think is due to come into place in April, as you say, sometime from tomorrow, at looking at the number of people or percentage of people that are in treatment. So because the current target, as others have said, that there's an issue around urgency and, 3 weeks can be far too long, for someone in crisis and needing treatment. And the MAT standards, are obviously focused at trying to address that. But the new treatment target is looking at the number of people in treatment and how long they stay in, because the other point is, retention and remaining in treatment and people not dropping out of the service if they're not getting the right support.
Yeah. So would you say there is a fear, much in the same way with rejected referrals within the CAM system, that the data we have before us, even if it was accurate and properly captured, doesn't necessarily represent the true scale of the problem if people are falling out of the system and then we no longer have any further data for them? Is that a legitimate concern?
Yeah, I mean, I think that data just isn't there at the moment.
Right, thank you very much indeed. And data gaps is something that we are quite concerned about, I have to say. I'm going to invite Colin Beattie, who's got a number of questions to put. Colin.
Thanks, Convener. General, I mean, obviously, everybody's very concerned about this. It's a big issue for Scotland, and it's something we've got to tackle. Is there any comfort to take from the fact that fewer young Scots are using drugs and alcohol? Now, I realise that on the older side, there's been an increase, but is there some comfort to take that from at the bottom end, where people are getting into the drugs and alcohol for the first time, that that's actually reducing? And also, the first 9 months of 2020 versus 2021, where there's been a 4% drop in deaths, is it too soon to think that that's a trend, or it's resulting from some of the initiatives that have taken place?
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Beattie. I think in terms of identifying the trend in terms of some of the recent data, I think it probably is too early to be definitive on that point. I think what we've looked to do in the exhibit is to try and, exhibit one, I should say, try and draw on some of the longer term averages to smooth out some of the impact of initiatives. And even as kind of touched on in the last question about data gaps, can take a bit of time. So there's a difference between, as we report further on in the paper, about some of the National Records of Scotland data and that from Police Scotland's estimates as well. So there's an overall issue about robustness of data that probably makes me hesitant in identifying any definitive patterns at this stage. I think, I guess, your overall question talks about, is there cause for optimism in terms of some of the choices that different groups in society, younger people, will make. And again, I'm reluctant to be definitive, and I think probably speaks to the overall point that we make in the report, that the government and their partners will want to be absolutely clear about what interventions are making the difference. You know, whether it's education and training for Scotland's young people, whether it's some of the emergency interventions, such as naloxone, that, you know, providing that to police officers, other emergency services and others to prevent death from overdose at the point of crisis, or whether it's some of the more the rehabilitation services that feature really prominently in the government's thinking, £100 million investment. All of those will want to be tested, evaluated, gather together the work of the Drug Test Task Force, the national mission, the strategy, so that it can be satisfied and clear as to what's making a difference, what's not, and do that in a really transparent way. As ever, I'm being hesitant, as you can tell, Mr. Beattie, to be definitive about, say that there is cause for optimism. The only one point I would make is that, and we note in the report, is that we are clear that there is much more focus from government and their partners in recent years than there perhaps was in the previous 3 or 4 years.
Let me move on to something slightly different. I mean, you've already mentioned about the funding. Sorry, did somebody else want to come in?
Your specific question around younger people. So the figures I've got to hand at the moment are for drug deaths, not sort of overall drug, you know, not drug use, but there has been an increase across all age groups in drug-related deaths, including the younger age groups. But it's been seen, the largest increase has been seen 35 to 44 and 45 to 54-year-olds. But the trends, we can send links, but the National Records of Scotland annual report on drug-related deaths shows the trends, and there's been upward trends in all age groups over the last few years on drug-related deaths. And the figures that we include in the briefing as well are around the suspected drug deaths, which have come from police figures. Because, you know, as we point out, that there's an issue with a lag in time lag in data. This is sort of newer figures that have been introduced to try and get more timely data. And there's actually been further data published since our briefing on the suspected deaths for the period ending October to December 21. It's showing there's now sort of two full calendar years. So that's showing 116 fewer suspected drug deaths in the calendar year of 2021 compared to 2020. And so it's slightly different. You know, it's a different source, slightly different from the actual figures are slightly different from the national NRS reports. But they do mirror quite closely. And I think because they're new, you know, they're just still looking to see how well they give an indication, but they are used more as an indication of, you know, of what things are looking like. But it has been the quarterly trends throughout 2021 have been reducing, and I think it'll be interesting to see when the NRS report comes out this year, which will be June, July, with the annual figures actually from, you know, death certificates. You know, how that's, will that actually mirror the police suspected deaths, and actually have come down for the first time? But we won't know that till summer.
Well, I certainly hope that it's looking a bit better.
Might I just comment on this point as well, if that's okay?
Sure.
I think I wanted to draw out the point in the briefing paper, which is the importance of prevention. Because obviously prevention is better than cure. And your question really hints at, can we turn the tap off and stop people getting involved in risky and dangerous and unhealthy drug and alcohol-related behaviours? I think the briefing paper is very clear. There's still a long way to go in terms of getting services collectively and the national drive towards that shift towards prevention.
Coming back to what was mentioned previously about funding arrangements, in your report you say they're complex and fragmented. What is the... I mean, that was the 2009 report, sorry, and it seems to be unchanged in your latest briefing. What do you think the impact on delivery of service has been because of those funding arrangements? And how can the Scottish Government make improvements in that area?
Yeah, I think, as well as funding, I think it's as much a question of partnership and delivery arrangements as well, actually. And I'm keen to bring Anthony in to say a bit more about how the overall structures work. Because what's clear, you mentioned complex and fragmented. I don't think we're differing our judgment in this briefing paper from the conclusions that we reached in earlier reports, that there are many partners involved in the delivery of services across the 31 alcohol and drug partnerships that we have in Scotland: councils, health boards, police, third sector organisations, all of which are responsible for preparation of local commissioning and strategies. There are plans for change, Mr. Beattie, as you'll know, through the what may come from the National Care Service, which is indicating that alcohol and drug services will be included in its remit. So there are opportunities for the government, the parliament, to scrutinise and to decide on if there are going to be more structural, fundamental change. Much like the discussion we had on social care, whilst there's an opportunity for change through the National Care Service, there is also an urgency with the structures that we have and the arrangements that we have at the moment, that we wouldn't want to kind of wait 5 years for that to happen to see the level of change, given some of the real urgency and the numbers that we're capturing in today's briefing paper. But if I may, I'm keen to bring Anthony in, if you're content, just to say a bit more.
And before Anthony comes in, is it then inevitable that, given the complexity of the stakeholders involved and the diversity of the stakeholders involved, that funding would be fragmented, and how can that be improved? Because obviously, you know, complex and fragmented isn't a good thing when you're trying to put together a strategy. Is it inevitable with the present system? Does the present system have to change?
Apologies, Anthony. You answer.
Feel free. If I might turn to that question after I've done a brief overview of the nature of the complexity of the arrangements, if that's okay, Mr. Beattie. I mean, I think we all know that people who experience difficulty with drug and alcohol services, it can lead to many problems in their lives, can't it? You know, problems with housing, with employment, with family circumstances, and so on and so forth. So it's quite proper, I think, that we have a range of different partners focusing on the needs and trying to support individuals. So the partnership arrangements, as the Auditor General said earlier, have been around for quite some time, in various forms since the late 1980s. Well, that's 25, 30 years, isn't it? So it's a long time. I don't think anybody's arguing that partnership isn't the way forward. But the reality is that because the partnerships have to engage with integration joint boards, councils, health boards, police authorities, the third sector, housing agencies, it can make it very difficult, I think, for the ADPs to influence and shape a range of different services. And I think that's one of the reasons why what we've seen in our previous reports is progress towards addressing specific issues to do with drug and alcohol support, but much more limited progress in making that bigger change, which is making the shift towards prevention. So I think there is an opportunity, as the Auditor General has said, in the thinking through around the National Care Service, to think about how can we get a greater focus on those wider systems changes, whilst at the same time providing better, more high quality, more impactful services, specifically for people with complex and severe drug and alcohol problems. As to the question of funding, I think it's really quite complicated, Mr. Beattie. I'm not sure there is an easy answer to this. What is clear, I think, from our discussions with ADPs is that the plethora of different funding streams and the way in which the funding is allocated does make it difficult, I think, for ADPs to plan for the long term. So I think there might be some opportunities of thinking through how longer-term funding could be allocated, or whether or not there are ways of providing funding in that gives ADPs a bit more flexibility and choice over how that funding is used. There'll always be a need, I think, to have core funding through health, police and fire as well. I don't think one would need to take that away. The challenge, though, is how the ADPs engage with police, housing and others to get the services shifted and changed in ways that will work. This story isn't unique to ADPs. I think it echoes some of the conversations we've had with you before around community justice authorities. It echoes some of the conversations your predecessor committees had around community planning partnerships. I think for us in Audit Scotland, there's a very interesting question around how do you make partnership working more effective and more impactful, which is something I think we want to consider as part of our longer-term work programme. So I hope that was helpful, Mr. Beattie.
It is. Just carrying on from that, the next question I was going to ask was actually about transparency, which you raised in paragraph 17. Is it inevitable that transparency is quite difficult to exhibit when the funding is so fragmented and there are so many stakeholders? Is the solution to the complexity of the funding also the solution to the transparency, I guess, is in some way what I'm saying?
Ginny may want to come in and add a bit more to this, and I see the Auditor General's mic's on as well, so maybe I should defer to the Auditor General first.
really no need, but I'll not decline the invitation. I guess there's a couple of things I'll touch on, and colleagues will undoubtedly elaborate, Mr. Beattie. That, maybe just focusing on the ADPs for a minute. So the ADPs prepare annual reports, and they're submitted to the Scottish Government. But there's not then a follow-through, I think I'm right in saying, for a production of an overall report on how ADPs have functioned in Scotland. We think that's a missing link, actually. We're not advocating structural change and that it has to be to bring further transparency. There are smaller things that could happen. It perhaps speaks to some of the kind of the point that the committee has heard from us in other topics in recent weeks, that there are many pots of funding in the delivery of public services. Some of it delivered by government, some of it goes outside government to partners, to other public bodies, third sector and beyond. What we don't have here is a clear picture of overall spending that's hard to pull together, and then, but more importantly, what the outcomes and impact that spending has produced. So I guess it's a question of transparency, yes, but also really what is delivering the biggest benefit, and really looking at the scale of the emergency that we're facing, that brings back to the urgency that government and their partners really need to know with clarity what impact, what's delivering the biggest benefit from that level of public spending. And I guess that's the kind of overall transparency will help, in our view, accelerate some of that thinking through, and ultimately hopefully we'd see as a real plan with deliverable and measurable outputs. I'll certainly pause though, and I'm sure colleagues will want to say more.
I don't have much to add to what the Auditor General said. Thank you very much, Mr. Beattie.
I think just to emphasise the point around the funding, that was one of the part of your question around how fragmented that is, and yes, it is, and there's different pots of money. I think what we found really difficult was to follow that through and kind of see what the overall funding was, which, even if there's lots of different pots of money, you should be able to see what the overall funding is, and we did struggle to kind of get a really clear picture of that, and that was through liaison with the Scottish Government as well. I think there's various announcements, some of the funding's published, some of it isn't, so it is difficult to then pull that all together and really to follow it through. So that's where clearly that we're saying there needs to be a lot more transparency around that.
Back to you, convener.
Thanks, Colin. I'm going to now turn to Willie Coffey, who's joining us through a video link, and Willie, it is a video link and not solely an audio link, so we can see you too. So over to you for your questions.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, everybody. Hopefully the video link will survive the next 5 minutes or so. Auditor General, I wanted to ask a couple of questions on early intervention and prevention, and maybe one on governance arrangements too. But firstly, I wonder, I've worked with a number of drug and alcohol projects over the years in my constituency, and if there was one key ask by those people at risk was that they needed a flexible and quickly accessible service they could call on to get help when they needed it. And I think there's good progress actually to report on this matter, and certainly in my constituency. But do you recognise that as an issue that has popped up from your discussions and your analysis of this particular problem? And how does that fit in with the work that the Scottish Government is trying to do in early intervention? It seems to be a huge issue for me and for the people in Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley. And in fact, Stephen, what it's leading to is more suicides in relation to this matter than we would like to have. Obviously, it's a serious issue, but it's a big point that's been raised with me several times, that direct and fast access to help and support services is crucial.
Good morning, Mr. Coffey. Thanks very much for the question, actually. And I think the themes that you're touching on are consistent with our reporting, not just in this briefing paper, but across many aspects of our work, that early targeted intervention leads to better outcomes from the delivery of public services and the experience that users get. So it's of no surprise through your own constituency work to hear that that's exactly what people who are using and relying on these acute public services are saying. It's not going to be the only approach. You know, I think I understand absolutely government's plans that it's a range of measures. Some are, you know, emergency intervention, mentioned the rollout of naloxone being one of the acute interventions that can take place and a necessary component of that. But actually, the early preventative work will be essential to delivering the level of change that Scotland needs. I think it's fair to say that through this briefing paper and some of our other work, we've drawn on and referenced back to the Christie Commission report, you know, of 10 plus years ago, that focused absolutely on early intervention, prevention as a way of delivering longer term sustained improvement in public services. And the regret those ambitions from Christie hadn't been realised, still talking about the implementation gap from well-intentioned policies. And I think really that's what I guess ultimately matters as to what comes next. Not just in drug and alcohol, as important and vital as it is, but really that was wider delivery of public service and the early interventions across many fronts will see the level of change in the quality of public services that we're all looking for. But absolutely agree with the premise of your question, Mr. Coffey, that those early interventions, those arrangements will make the longer term difference to not just drug and alcohol services, but absolutely in the round. And forgive me, sorry, I should say actually as important as drug and alcohol services as they are, that many of the challenges are deep seated, you know, across communities in Scotland that will require policy intervention across a number of fronts to deliver the level of change that we're looking for.
You were saying also in your report, Stephen, that the government hasn't been particularly clear on the kind of level of spending that's being targeted at early intervention and prevention. Could you just say a few words about that and what should they be doing to clarify or improve that aspect of it?
Yeah, you're quite right, actually. And colleagues can contribute as they wish. We do that at paragraph 18 to the report. So we've effectively noted here that, that the percentage of spending targeted on early interventions hadn't been clearly set out by government. And I probably just reiterates, I think, the point that Gillian made a few minutes ago, that there needs to be absolute clarity in the planned spending, what feels like a fairly fragmented structure at the moment, with spending being delivered across many different organisations and complex governance and accountability set up. And in our view, that hampers both the clarity of what actually is making the difference, both in terms of early intervention and some of the more reactive spend, and really speaks to the overall conclusion that we make in today's briefing paper of the need for an overarching plan with milestones that's reported annually against progress across the national mission, the rights recovery respect strategy, and the work of the Drug Desk Task Force. So we're keen to see government reflect that in their updated plans that we anticipate they'll be producing over the course of the summer.
Do you also note that, I mean, there's a number of competing projects locally, and I'm sure they're in all the members' constituencies, projects that are competing for this kind of support and funding tackle these issues. Is that, what extent is that a problem that's preventing us getting from where we need to be? Because I encounter it quite a lot down here, Stephen, where groups are almost arguing with one another that they should be receiving financial support to deliver these services. And there doesn't seem to me to be any clear way through this about who delivers the best solution on the ground.
Yeah, Mr. Coffey, I'm going to ask Anthony to come in a moment to say a bit about how the partnership working is working, you know, to be, in fairness, successfully in many places. But if the commissioning model turns into competition from the various providers, the extent to which that's a barrier to delivering effective services. Anthony.
Thank you, Stephen. Just to pick up on this point, I think there is evidence from our audit work and from other reports that for the third sector, it does feel like there's sometimes an imbalance of power in terms of their ability to access resources and contribute to developing and implementing new services, many of which I think would be focused on prevention and avoiding people relapsing back into problem drug and alcohol behaviour. So there is an issue around that, I think, that needs to be thought about in terms of the commissioning arrangements, the local planning arrangements, and the way in which ADPs work with partners across different sectors as well. So that's a very fair point, Mr. Coffey. So I think we'd recognise your observations there more widely. And just going back to your starting point of your question, Mr. Coffey, to do with the shift towards prevention, in the briefing paper, I think we do highlight other evidence that supports your kind of overall position, really, which is the Hard Edge report that we reference in Para 20 that highlights the real need for quite significant shifts of arrangements and planning for delivering not just these types of services, but services for other people that have complex needs. So it's very clear that there's still much more that can be done by public bodies working with others to become much more flexible and much more focused on the needs of people, families and communities, to deliver different types of services that will deliver the better outcomes that Stephen was identifying. And later on in the briefing paper, we highlight the issue of the lack of access to some community-based services being a problem for people passing through the criminal justice system as well, which can be a problem, leading people back into the criminal justice system when perhaps if other services had been available, they might have had better outcomes, if I can put it that way.
Mm-hmm. That's a really important point, Anthony, especially during COVID, when people were coming out of the criminal justice system, as you put it, they were finding access to these support services particularly difficult. I know that from experience locally. So if we can do anything to reinstate and recover that aspect of the service, I think that would really contribute towards turning this around, at least in part. I just wanted to ask a last question about a governance aspect of it, Stephen. Your report also reminds us that the government and COSLA had agreed 8 recommendations to improve the whole governance and accountability of the various services, and that led to the development of the partnership delivery framework for alcohol and drug partnerships. So could you say a wee bit more about how that has been progressing, please?
If we're able to, we will, Mr. Coffey. I think, like you, we note the work the government and COSLA are doing together and the 8 recommendations, and we touch on this at paragraph 24 to the report. I'm not sure we have an update on it, although I think that the Minister, in one of her written responses, noted the progress and that there's planned publication of progress against the recommendation that's pending. But if I'll pause for a moment, just check with colleagues if we have any further information on how that's progressing. No, I don't think we do. So if we're able to, we'll come back in writing, but it may be something that the committee could maybe to pick up with the government and COSLA directly.
Yeah, I think that's something we'll probably follow up. Thanks very much for that from both of you. Thanks, Camille. Back to you.
Thanks, Willie. And I'm going to turn to a final couple of questions to Sharon Dowie, who is also joining us via video link this morning. So, Sharon, over to you.
Good morning. Another question on governance, looking at paragraphs 28 and 29. The Scottish Government consultation on a new national care service shows that a majority of respondents agree that ADPs should be integrated into community health and social care boards. What is your assessment of the cost of doing so, and would this improve lines of accountability?
So it'll be interesting to see, Ms. Dowie, as to where, how the structure of the National Care Service evolves, following the government's response to the consultation. If it is the case that alcohol and drug services are included under the National Care Service and whatever shape and structure, I think we see that as an opportunity to bring clarity to some of the challenges that we note in the report about complex, difficult to navigate governance structures. That it's captured in a clear plan, but Anthony's mentioned already, in terms of bringing out the real benefits of partnership working, but with clearer accountability and setting out what the intended, measurable, transparent outcomes will come from that. What we haven't done, in direct answer to your question, is undertaken any assessment of the cost or full benefits of that. As we refer to in today's briefing paper, that we plan to undertake further work both on drug and alcohol services and very likely progress that will be made towards a national care service. So there's opportunities for us to report further to the committee on how the government's plans for national care services and drug and alcohol services are developing.
Okay, thank you. And moving on, one of the lines that kind of stuck out in the report quite a bit was the most concerning, was that most drug-related deaths are in people aged 35 to 54, but this is increasing across all age groups, particularly in people aged 25 to 34, which was something that Gillian Matthews referred to earlier on. So it's a focus of all parties that the increased funding gives vastly improved outcomes. So we noted that you recommend a number of actions that the Scottish Government needs to take at paragraph 31 to increase transparency and demonstrate value for money and the funding for drug and alcohol services. Has the Scottish Government accepted that this work needs to be progressed? And if so, has it set any interim targets for undertaking the work?
So you're right in terms of the impact of funding really is one of the core purpose of today's paper, that we're keen that the government sets out transparently, as we've mentioned once or twice already this morning, that the spending on drug and alcohol services, it's clear to government, their partners and users of the services, what's making the most difference. Through our reporting, we obviously have cleared our report with government in terms of accuracy, and we note the some of the ministerial responses that welcoming our report. What then translates into the government's plans, we'll continue to engage with them, and we'll see what comes next in terms of our recommendation that there is an overarching plan that draws together the national mission, the strategy and the work of the Drug Death Task Force. And ultimately, as we hope, delivers clear, transparent, improved outcomes as part of our ongoing work, effectively, is our answer, Ms. Dowie.
Right, that's fine. Thank you.
OK, well, look, thank you very much indeed. I think on that note, we're going to draw this evidence session to an end. And thanks, as always, to the Auditor General, to Anthony Clark and to Gillian Matthew for joining us this morning. We've looked with a great deal of interest at the briefing paper and the evidence you've provided, and we'll clearly need to consider what our next steps are as a public audit committee. But thank you very much for your time this morning, and I will now move the meeting into private session.